Hi there, my Why Religion friends. Professor Anthony Sweat here from BYU Church History and Doctrine. Welcome to another edifying and enlightening episode of the Why Religion podcast. As you can see by today's title of the show, it centers on better understanding the law of consecration. For Latter-day Saints, this is a pinnacle covenant that we commit to obey as part of our sacred temple covenants with God. The trouble is that for such a crucial covenant, it is often misunderstood, even by the faithful who covenant to live it. A number of years ago, I did a baseline pre-class quiz with over 700 BYU students in a Doctrine and Covenants class just to check their understanding on various concepts. One of the questions dealt with their understanding of the law of consecration. This is how it read. The law of consecration, A, is not practiced by the church today. B, is not practiced in the church today, but will be brought back in the millennium. C, is practiced in part in the church today through tithes and offerings, but not in full. Or D, is practiced in full in the church today. Which option do you think the students selected most? Well, half of the students selected option C, that said that consecration is only partly practiced in the church through tithes and offerings, but not in full, as though tithing is somehow a lesser law of Moses interim, and we're waiting for future full consecration to come about. As further evidence of this, 31% of the students selected option B, that said that consecration was not practiced at all in the church today, but will be brought back one day in the millennium. Only 17% of my BYU students chose option D, that consecration is practiced in full in the church today. Professor Steven Harper of BYU's Department of Church History and Doctrine has researched and written extensively on the law of consecration and has recently published a fabulous new book in the Let's Talk About series with Deseret Book called Let's Talk About the Law of Consecration that helps to articulate revealed principles about the law of consecration rather than rumors or folk doctrines that get passed around, such as tithing somehow being a lesser law or waiting till the millennium to live it.
It's a folk doctrine, and it therefore can get in the way, if we believe it, it can get in the way of believing revealed doctrine. So I wanted to study and then share what I learned from what the revelations actually say about the law of consecration.
In today's episode, Dr. Harper takes us into the Doctrine and Covenants and church history to articulate and help shine a light on what the revelations say about the law of consecration, how we can understand it and live it, and why it is the ultimate expression of discipleship for Latter-day Saints. This is Why Religion.
Each year, religion professors at Brigham Young University produce hundreds of publications on subjects related to the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This podcast brings this research into one place to enlighten the everyday seeker of truth.
Seek learning, even by study and also by faith.
Interviewing the author, we discuss why the study was done, why it matters, and why the professor chooses to be both a scholar and a disciple. This is Why Religion, research to enlighten your mind.
Recently, Professor Casey Griffiths interviewed his colleague, Dr. Steven Harper, to interview him about his book publication on the law of consecration. In part one, Professor Harper will tell us why he did this publication, taking us into understanding some of the history and basic principles and practices of consecration to help us understand it and implement it today. Here is Dr. Casey Griffiths interviewing Dr. Steven Harper.
All right, Steve, thank you for joining us today. And the book we're talking about is called Let's Talk About the Law of Consecration. This is actually a series, correct?
Yes, one book in a series of several books, all authored by different people.
And give us a sample of the titles in the series.
Carrie Muhlstein's is on the Book of Abraham. Brittany Chapman Nash wrote on plural marriage. Terrell Givens writing on faith and reason. Dan Judd on mental health and religion. So I think there'll be others as well.
That. Yeah, I've heard Paul Reeve is writing one on race and the priesthood.
I hope so.
I'm excited to read that one. I've already read Carey's, and just incredibly small, compact, useful information on some controversial subjects.
Yeah, controversial and lesser known, I think. Mm-hmm. I don't think they intended just to deal with controversial stuff, but maybe stuff that hadn't been talked about that should be talked about.
And as an example of that, I was a little surprised to see, because I knew about the series, that there was a volume on consecration. It doesn't seem like consecration's incredibly controversial. Would you classify it as controversial or lesser known? Or what was the motivation behind the book?
Yeah, I think of it as lesser known. Not so much controversial, but one of those issues about which we think we know something, and what we think we know is actually commonly misinformation. And so it makes it difficult to, you know, to live up to our privileges and blessings, covenants and obligations if we don't really know what they're about.
One of the questions you address is that there seems to be this prevalent belief among the saints that we don't live the law of consecration any longer, that we lived it once, but the Lord hasn't asked us to. And someday, maybe after the Savior's return, we'll live the law of consecration. How would you address that?
Well, really, that idea is the reason for writing the book, mm-hmm. because I took that idea that you just articulated with me to my covenant-making experience in the temple, and realized that that knowledge, or mistaken knowledge I thought I had, couldn't be exactly right based on what I experienced in the temple. So I determined I would figure out what the scriptures and the history of the law of consecration is. And it's quite different, of course, than the some scholars have called what you articulated a folk doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning it kind of came from the saints rather than from God. And that's true. You don't find it revealed. That's not a revealed truth. That's an understanding that grows over time. Joseph Smith didn't have it. Wilford Woodruff didn't. So it's a folk doctrine, and it therefore can get in the way. If we believe it, it can get in the way of believing revealed doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to study and then share what I learned from what the revelations actually say about the law of consecration.
Yeah, the reason for this folk doctrine you write is, first, it simplifies what's really complex. It's simple, memorable, and an easy explanation for why things are the way they are. Second, it excuses us. It places the blame for failing to live the law of consecration on the early saints, and it puts the responsibility for living the law of consecration onto future saints. The story we tell, this folk doctrine, seems to conveniently absolve me here and now from confronting the law of consecration and keeping my covenant. Now, that folk doctrine could be really comforting because the law of consecration is challenging in a lot of aspects. Give us some background on how the law of consecration developed and what the law of consecration actually is.
Well, we could say that the law of consecration is the law of the universe. It's one way to give background on it is to say, well, in February 1831, the Lord revealed it, but I would go even further back and say that the foundational doctrine, the truth on which the law of consecration depends, is who God is and our relationship to God.
Mm-hmm.
So we are creations of God. We owe everything to God, the creator of the universe. So all material resources, all spiritual blessings, our lives, all flow from a generous God. And God has laws. And these laws enable us to live in covenant relationship with Him and with each other. And when we do that, that leads to the greatest happiness and redemption from the effects of the fall, from sin and death. And so we want to know what these laws are, and we want to live by them. One of them is consecration. And it's again based on this idea that the psalmist expresses beautifully, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, all of us who dwell in it. This doctrine is in all of the standard works. It's in the book of Moses, it's in the book of Abraham, it's in the Old Testament, as you know. Mm-hmm. It's in the New Testament. King Benjamin taught it beautifully in the Book of Mormon and others. And it is replete, it's pervasive in the Doctrine and Covenants. So the law of consecration is for us to understand our relationship to God and everything He's provided for us, including our lives, and then to make our lives sacred, to devote them to God and God's purposes because of our love for Him and our love for His children. In some ways, it's really nothing more or less than a way of living out the two great commandments. Consecrating something, including our life, is making it sacred, devoting it to God's purposes. God has made us free. We can do whatever we want with our lives. I can devote my life to ESPN if I want. I devote a significant portion of it to that. But I can decide to make my life sacred by consecrating it. And the command in the Doctrine and Covenants, in the Law of Consecration, section 42 of the Doctrine and Covenants, is to remember the poor and consecrate of thy properties for their support, that which thou hast to impart unto them, with a covenant indeed that can't be broken. So the command is to remember the poor and make the things that God has provided sacred to relieve poverty, to relieve suffering. It goes on from there. It's more than that, but that's the gist of it and the heart of it, really.
So at the heart of it is this idea that you remember the poor and you consecrate what you have to God. How come there is this perception, address this folk doctrine of why Latter-day Saints have sort of grown into believing, well, that was then, but right. Now we don't do the same thing?
Well, it's a terrific question, Casey, and I have yet to do enough historical research to figure out exactly how it developed, when and where. But I'll tell you that the earliest saints did not think that way and did not teach it that way. Mm-hmm. It, in other words, has emerged since then. And I can think of, you know, some sort of landmarks along the way, but what I can say with great confidence is that I don't know why it developed, but it does work. Meaning, let me try to be clearer. That folk doctrine, the idea that God revealed the law of consecration to the early saints, but they couldn't do it, so He suspended or revoked or rescinded it, and someday in the future, the saints will live it again. That idea does important work for people. Mm-hmm. The work it does is what you referred to earlier. It excuses me now, right? Notice that it blames people in the past for the reason I'm not as obligated to live the law as I otherwise would be. Mm-hmm. And it puts onto my children or grandchildren the obligation to measure up to it. So what it does is lets me relax regarding the law of consecration. Mm-hmm. But as you know, Elder Neil A. Maxwell, Quorum of the 12 Apostles, taught that covenant keepers experience a divine discontent, this feeling that comes at the intersection of progression and procrastination, he calls it. So let's say I want to be a covenant keeper, and then let's say I'm also a natural man who doesn't want to prioritize the hard work of devoting my life to God and God's children. Well, then I face this divine discontent. And one way to respond to that, a bad way, is to explain away why I don't have to keep my covenants here and now. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to do that anymore. I want to understand what my covenants are. I want to understand what the law of consecration is, as revealed in the Doctrine and Covenants. And then I want to understand, what do I need to do now with regard to that law? And that will help me to be be more, to get rid of that divine discontent and replace it with the satisfaction of well done, good and faithful servant.
So let's address a couple of those questions you just brought up, specifically what the law of consecration is. There's a place in the book where you describe the law of consecration like a three-legged stool. Tell us what those three legs are and how each one plays out.
I find this to be a very useful analogy because if you've got a three-legged stool, of course, it doesn't work if you take any of the legs off the stool. Mm-hmm. And similarly, the Doctrine and Covenants is, as you know, as well as I, you've written on this yourself, you know these revelations as well as anyone. It repeatedly and emphatically emphasizes three doctrines in relation to lots of things, but including in relation to the law of consecration. And so those three doctrines I compare to legs on the consecration stool. And in no particular order, it's not one of these is important than more important than another. If you don't, if you lose any of them, you don't have the stool. You don't have the law. So agency is one of them. The law is emphatic. The Lord is clear that He has made us free to act for ourselves. He's given us a law to act upon and made us free to act for ourselves. This is one reason we maybe made up the rationale for why we didn't have to. We know we're free. We know we're expected to act here and now. And so we sometimes tell stories about why we don't have to do what we otherwise might know we should do. Mm-hmm. So we have to act. The second leg or another leg on the stool is stewardship. Stewardship is what God has given me to act upon, and the revelations are clear about this. Joseph Smith's teachings are clear about this. So a stewardship is anything I can act upon as a free agent. This is my time. This is spiritual gifts. This is an automobile that I might have possession of, a college education, all right? Anything that we can act upon is within our stewardship. And then finally, the doctrine of accountability is emphasized throughout. The free agents who are empowered by God to act upon the stewardships He gives them to act upon will be accountable to Him for how they act. It's not a situation where we can do whatever we want and the consequences will be whatever we choose. The consequences will be what God has said they are, and He will hold us accountable. He's the owner of the universe and everything in it. He redeemed us. He owns us, as the New Testament emphasizes. He has set us free to act for ourselves, but we will account to Him for how we acted on His law. And I'm grateful for that understanding. It's really clear. It's set forth very clearly throughout the Doctrine and Covenants, and it helps me to understand what the law is and how I relate to it, including in, you know, in the 21st century. We can see how these doctrines apply to us here now, as well as they ever did to anybody there then.
And that might be a good jumping off point for the next question, which is, in the 21st century, how do we apply these principles of consecration that you've just so carefully explained?
Yeah, this one is especially a good question because conscientious covenant keepers read the Doctrine and Covenants carefully and they say, you know, the bishop in section 51, Bishop Partridge is told to make a writing, you know, to give the saints printed documents that secure to them their inheritance in Zion, and so forth. And we think, well, that doesn't happen today. Is there something wrong? Can I possibly keep the law of consecration? Because several of the revelations have in them these instructions that don't seem relevant or applicable today. And the way to understand that is to find in the revelations the timeless principles, the tactics of acting out the law of consecration change. They have changed, they are changing, and we can expect that they will continue to do so. But the doctrines of the law are not changing, and you and I and everyone else can choose how we will act relative to those doctrines in the 21st century. Mm-hmm. So, for example, the commandment is remember the poor and consecrate of thy property for their support. Well, there's nothing that keeps me from doing that except my own agency. I can find ways to do that, and the church has wonderful ways to do that. You've been a bishop. I'm serving as a bishop. You know that the saints are incredibly faithful in the payment of offerings and things that relieve poverty and suffering. What did President Oaks say in conference? $906 million toward poverty relief and so forth. And I think that just tips the iceberg of the history of what's been done. So I think it's the case that me and maybe other saints could do better at keeping the command to remember the poor and consecrate what we have for their support. But it's also true, demonstrably true, that Latter-day Saints are incredibly faithful at remembering the poor and relieving poverty and suffering. So we don't have to wait for to go back to the kind of forms Bishop Partridge used in the 1830s. Mm-hmm. We just find in present church practices, as President Romney put it, the principles of the law, and we just do what we can do now here in the 21st century to do what the law requires.
Now, Steve, you mentioned you're serving as a bishop right now. I know when I served in that calling, it completely changed my perspective on consecration. In fact, that's what sent me down the rabbit hole to try and find out what consecration was. How has your service in that calling affected your view of consecration?
It's really beautiful to watch the saints bless and help each other. When you're a bishop, you're privy to one of your responsibilities is to seek out the poor and minister to their relief. And a bishop is responsible to do that. Most of that responsibility actually falls on the shoulders of the Relief Society president, mm-hmm. who does much of the hard work. And so one of the beautiful things of being a bishop is you're privy to that. Most ward members dutifully offer their offerings for relief of the poor, but they don't necessarily know which of their neighbors is blessed and relieved. And as a bishop, you get to see that at close range, and it is sacred and very beautiful. There are people in need, even in my middle-class neighborhood, and their needs are met. The storehouse is always full. It's remarkable. You know this too, right? Mm-hmm. It's no matter how much you need to meet people's needs, that storehouse fills back up. And it's a testament to the faithfulness of Latter-day Saints and good people everywhere that acute needs can be relieved and blessed. People who otherwise would have nowhere to turn, who would go hungry or sick or otherwise serious trouble, can get the help they need. It's a huge relief to them, not just temporally, but mentally and spiritually, to know that they're not going to starve or not going to be left out, and that their neighbors have their back.
Yeah.
It's really beautiful.
Yeah, and I know we keep this confidential, so usually the only people that know everything that's going on in a ward are the bishop and the Relief Society president, who, like you said, play a key role. And maybe we underappreciate the Relief Society president, too. Can you give us just a brief summary of the role a Relief Society president plays in consecration?
Yeah, when I was a kid, I think of myself as a child of the Relief Society. Mm-hmm. My mother, for example, would take my younger brother and I when we were very young. And so this would be before we were going to school. Our older siblings were in school. And we would sometimes get dropped off at a neighbor's house with other kids, play with them. Or sometimes we'd go with mom to errands. So we'd go to the Desert Industries, to the Bishop's Storehouse, or we'd go today what we call ministering, right? Well, I was a grown man before I realized that I was watching the work of the Relief Society get done. Mm-hmm. I was watching a frontline soldier live the law of consecration. I don't know if she ever even said those words. She'd just say, "Let's go." And so she was relieving poverty under the direction of her bishop. and often not as the Relief Society president, as in what we called in those days a visiting teacher. Mm-hmm. And so that's how I learned how this work gets done, quietly, behind the scenes, by faithful Christian souls who love God with their whole heart and love their neighbors as themselves. And since then, I've studied the Relief Society, you know, both in the past and the present. And this is what it does. Among many other wonderful things, the Relief Society relieves society's suffering, its poverty, its stresses and acute needs. We could go on and on about some very specific and beautiful examples, as you know. You could tell your own versions of this, but I am so grateful for the Relief Society. I've had the privilege of serving with several Relief Society presidents, each of whom brings wonderful gifts, power to the calling, and blesses people that need their help.
Yeah. And we can't, again, I can't say enough good about Relief Society presidents and what they do to alleviate poverty and suffering.
They really are the foot soldiers of this work.
Yeah.
They're the ones who are on the ground, in the homes, discerning what needs there are and meeting those needs immediately. It's really something to watch.
If you're interested in more peer-reviewed, high-quality gospel scholarship about Latter-day Saint history, doctrine, or practice, such as this publication, BYU's Religious Studies Center is a great place for you to check out. As the collective church studies the New Testament this 2023 year with Come Follow Me, the RSC has recently published a new book called Learn of Me, History and Teachings of the New Testament, edited by John Hilton III and Nicholas Frederick from BYU Ancient Scripture. This volume of collected essays is intended to assist disciples of Jesus Christ in coming to a deeper understanding of the Savior and his ministry through their personal study of the New Testament. Because the period and culture of the New Testament can be daunting to some modern readers, the editors gather the work of Latter-day Saint scholars who have devoted time and research to gain greater understanding of the New Testament. The editors included essays written from a variety of perspectives to highlight the different lenses that productively can be brought to bear on the New Testament. Some of these essays are overtly devotional, while others are more explicitly academic, but all are written with the intent to help each of us accomplish one goal, to learn of Him. Again, the book is called Learn of Me, History and Teachings of the New Testament. Check it out and pick it up at rsc.byu.edu. We've been listening to Professor Steven Harper discuss his recent book publication, Let's Talk About the Law of Consecration, published by Deseret Book. In part two of Why Religion, we like to explore a little bit more why this research matters. How can it inform or help us in living, learning, or loving aspects of the restored gospel of Jesus Christ? In this part, Dr. Harper is going to answer some frequently misunderstood questions regarding consecration, including why tithing did not replace the law of consecration as a lesser law.
Let's address some common questions about consecration.
Right.
So there is a perception that there was no private property under consecration. We all lived on a farm, and you know, it was your day to use the horse or
right.
my day to use the horse. Was there private property under consecration in Joseph Smith's day?
There sure was, and it's explicit in section 42 in the revelation of the law itself. Stewards over their own property, the Lord says. The law of consecration never did envision communal ownership of property. That undermines that doctrine of stewardship, private stewardship. So there have been instances, as you know, when Joseph got to Kirtland, Ohio, he found there saints who were trying to live the best they could, the early Christian order that they read about in the Book of Acts. And so they were struggling to figure out if they should have communal ownership and so forth, and in response to that, the Lord gave section 42 of the Doctrine comes and said, that's not what consecration is.
Mm-hmm.
Orderville, Utah was an attempt by saints to live a kind of a communal order, but that didn't match what the revelations say. So there have been instances where saints or proto-Latter-day Saints have tried it in a kind of communal way, but that's not what the revelation of the law of consecration asks for or commands or directs. Now, we might well say here that on the one hand, it doesn't call for communal ownership of property, but it does call, and some people get nervous when they hear me say this, it does call for a socialization of surplus income voluntarily. Mm-hmm. So the revelations are very clear on this point. That is, free agents of their own free will offer their property into the Lord's storehouse, and under the direction of the church leaders, it gets distributed according to the Lord's will and the people's needs. And that may make some people uncomfortable. The difference between that, the law of consecration, and the world's way of doing that is the world's way of doing it is coercive, and the Lord's way of doing it is not coercive. People do it of their own free will, and that's really an important principle. So I guess on the one hand, we want to say it's not an accurate depiction of the law of consecration to think of it as a communal ownership. God owns everything under the law of consecration, and we are private stewards of individual stewardships, and we act on them of our own free will, either according to God's will or not, and we account to Him for the way we act. And it's also not a, it's really important to remember that part of it too. It's in the culture we live in, as you know, private ownership is a powerful, dominant principle. And it can have the effect of undermining the law of consecration if we overemphasize private ownership as if it was an end in itself. Mm-hmm. I'm thankful that we live in a free country where we're free to live the law of consecration if we want to, and not coerced or compelled either to do so or not to do so. But a danger of that, of the philosophical underpinnings of our culture, are that we could come to believe that we're God, right? I own it. It's mine. Mm-hmm. Now, if you think this is me just giving you my opinion, just read section 104. You don't. You know what I'm talking about.
I know what you're talking about, yeah.
Section 104 of the Doctrine and Covenants will, a careful reading of that will correct anybody who thinks that I just went my own way there.
You mentioned there's a quote in the book from an institute teacher, Jack Manis,
yeah,
who was teaching over Zoom. And he asked his class, what do you understand now about the law of consecration? Now that you've read the revelations, this young lady wrote, it's not about the stuff. It's about recognizing that all we have is from our Heavenly Father and that we're willing to use it for His purposes. And I was amazed at how closely she, without knowing it, had quoted J. Reuben Clark, who sets up the church welfare system. J. Reuben Clark says the basic principle of all the revelations on the United Order is that everything we have belongs to the Lord. Therefore, the Lord may call upon us for any and all the property which we have because it belongs to Him. This is the basic principle.
Isn't that great?
That's amazing that the Spirit just spoke to a member of the First Presidency and an institute student, and they basically get the same idea from it. Okay, so let's address another question. Did the law of tithing replace the law of consecration?
This makes me think of a list of questions and answers Joseph said he was frequently asked, where, you know, he says, isn't the canon of the Bible closed? No, or it would have said so, he says. So did tithing replace the law of consecration? No, or the Doctrine and Covenants would have said so. What the Doctrine and Covenants actually says is, in section 119, is that tithing is what we would think of as part of consecration. Tithing is one way to live the law of consecration. It's part of it, not instead of it. Now, I know there are a couple of sentences in the heading of 119 that make it quite confusing, but the revelation itself was not understood that way, and it doesn't say that. The section heading to 119 says, "Revelation given through Joseph Smith, the prophet of Far West Missouri, July 8, 1838, in answer to his supplication, O Lord, show unto thy servants how much thou requirest of the properties of thy people for a tithing." So that's really good. That's accurate information. It comes right out of Joseph Smith's journal. And on this day in 1838, the church is in a tough financial time. This is, as you know, right in the middle of an international economic collapse. The church is in debt quite a bit for the construction of the temple in Kirtland, Ohio. And now it's contemplating the building of a new temple in Far West Missouri. And so we've got lots of challenges, how to pay for all these things, how to build Zion. And the two bishops, Bishop Partridge and Bishop Whitney, have proposed to Joseph variations on tithing. So we might assume that everybody knows what tithing is in 1838. Everybody knows it's a tenth. Well, they don't. The revelations prior to this have not said anything about a tenth. Tithing has been used synonymously with any free will offering of any amount. So when we read the revelations, we got to get rid of our preconceived notions about what they mean and assumptions and figure out what they meant to them there then. So that's an important principle of that. If you want to understand tithing, what it meant initially, you have to start with what was in the minds of Joseph Smith, Bishop Partridge, Bishop Whitney. So what's in their minds at this point is, let's get back to living the law of consecration by inviting the saints to tithe. Bishop Whitney's was pretty simple. Bishop Partridge's was a complicated financial formula based on his expertise. Joseph says, let's ask the Lord. And so they seek and receive this revelation. And notice that it says, "Thus saith the Lord, I require all their surplus property to be put into the hands of the bishop of my church in Zion for the building of my house, the laying of the foundation of Zion, for the priesthood, the debts of the presidency of my church. This shall be the beginning of the tithing of my people." This is a restatement of the purposes of the law of consecration in section 42. It's not superseding it. It's restating it. And then notice verse 3. That's the beginning of the tithing. So this is the first of three uses of the word tithing or tithe in section 119. All three of them refer back to verse 1, the free will offering of all surplus property. After that, those who have thus been tithed, verse 4 says, shall pay one-tenth of all their interest annually. This shall be a standing law to them forever. So not a temporary law to be replaced someday, not a lower law. Notice that the words lower and higher are, those are words we apply to the scriptures, but the scriptures don't use. The scriptures don't talk about lower laws and higher laws. They don't say tithing is a lower law and consecration a higher law. They don't think that way. But we do. We've imposed that on it. And we have to be careful that we don't make the scriptures mean something they don't mean or didn't ever say. Anyway, you know the revelation. It goes on like that. The last usage of tithe is in verse 5, tithe of their surplus properties. And it goes on to say that this is vital. This is crucial. Zion can't be built. So tithing is part of consecration. It's not instead of consecration. That's easy to misunderstand because in the heading, it says, the Lord had previously given to the church the law of consecration and stewardship of property. That's true. That law is in section 42 of the Doctrine and Covenants. But in that same sentence, it says, which members, chiefly the leading elders, entered into by a covenant that was to be everlasting. Now, that part of the sentence tells us that the law of consecration that applies to all saints everywhere in section 42 is being conflated with a later covenant that leaders of the church were to enter with regard to their management of church assets and properties. So that covenant, as you know, is foreshadowed in section 78. It's stated in section 82, and then it's nullified in section 104. That's the covenant that the leading elders entered. And it really has nothing to do, well, it certainly has to do with the law of consecration. When saints live the law of consecration, you've got to have church policies, programs, personnel in place to manage. And that's what's being talked about in the second half of that sentence. Sorry to be complicated, but in other words, the sentence is confusing two different covenants. Mm-hmm. One is the covenant all Latter-day Saints are obligated to keep to live the law of consecration. Mm-hmm. The other one is the covenant that only between 9 and 12 Latter-day Saint leaders ever were part of, the United Order or United Firm, to manage the church under the law of consecration. And then it says, because of failure on the part of many, and this is confusing, I don't know what the word many refers to. Many church members who are under covenant to live the law of consecration in section 42, or many of the church leaders under covenant, the covenant of section 82, to live according to a united order or a management firm. Because of the failure on the part of many to abide this covenant, the Lord withdrew it for a time. That makes me think that this sentence is referring to section 104. Which nullifies the covenant of section 82 that essentially a dozen church leaders had entered. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not trying to blame anybody or cause further confusion, but what I'm just saying there is that the revelation itself is not that confusing. It's pretty simple and straightforward, and it simply says tithing is now part of consecration. But a confusing and pretty complicated history can leave us under the impression that the Lord took the law of consecration away and he'll restore it again someday. But that's not what the scriptures say.
Yeah. And I think it misses the point, too, that tithing is primarily financial. Consecration is holistic.
Right.
It's not about your money. It's about yourself, your time. The gifts that you've been given and everything that you can give. So I'm living the law of consecration when I give my next door neighbor who's a new convert to the church a ride to sacrament meeting.
Well said. You know, another way to put it too is we're living the law of consecration when we do what Revelation section 42 calls receive by consecration, right? Let's say I need groceries from the bishop's storehouse this month. Well, I am living the law of consecration when I receive that offering from God, that manifestation of love from him and from his children to me. Mm-hmm. So you're right. It encompasses everything. There's hardly any aspect of our lives that's not covered by the law of consecration, because to consecrate is to make sacred. It's to devote ourselves to God's purposes. And you either sort of devote your whole soul, as the beautiful Book of Mormon says, or you don't. Another way to say it is all in. There's a family in my ward I wrote about in the book. On the back of their van, there's a little bumper sticker that just says all in. And everybody who knows that family understands that it means consecrated. And they don't shout it from the housetops. They just do it. They just go about their daily lives that way.
If you're interested in Professor Harper's book, Let's Talk About the Law of Consecration, published by Deseret Book, we've provided a link to it on our website at yreligion.byu.edu. There, we have also provided a link to an open and free access article that Dr. Harper published a few years ago with the Religious Study Center called All Things Are the Lord's, The Law of Consecration in the Doctrine and Covenants. All right, we've arrived at our last segment, part three of Why Religion, where we like to discuss things a little bit more personally with a professor. Since Steve has been on this podcast before, twice actually, both episode number 55 on the best of BYU studies and episode number 4 on remembering the first vision. To conclude this episode, we don't go into his academic background and training and journey to BYU. But I'd highly recommend that you listen to those other episodes if you've enjoyed this one to learn more from Dr. Harper and his training and expertise. So to conclude this episode, Professor Harper is going to share some insights about how he approaches challenging or difficult questions related to the gospel or the restored church.
Well, let's shift gears for the final part of our conversation. And you've been on Why Religion a couple times before. So we talked today about maybe getting your insights on how to deal with challenging or difficult questions. That's what this series is devoted to, challenging, difficult, or underexplored topics in the gospel. So when you come across a hard question, what's your method for dealing with and finding satisfying answers to those questions?
This is a great question. This is what you and I do every day, right? Mm-hmm. Do this ourselves and then try to help our students learn the methods, the principles, the practices. So lately, I've been telling my students to think slowly. And that might seem like a terrible thing to do, but let me say what I mean. A couple of Israeli psychologists spent their careers studying biases, human biases, and especially heuristics, or the mental shortcuts that people make that are related to biases. And when we do that, they call that thinking fast. The book about this is thinking fast and slow. Mm. So, for example, one of their examples is if you ask 100 people, are you an above average driver? 90 some percent will say they are. Mm-hmm. Not based on any evidence whatsoever or analysis, just a heuristic, a mental shortcut. Well, that is the way we do most of our thinking. That's the way we go about our daily lives. And thankfully, right, there's a lot of just mundane stuff that we can function perfectly fine in by thinking fast. But when it comes to ultimate questions, thinking slowly is the right way. And I find, as you likely could attest to, that our students sometimes are not very skilled at slowing down their thinking. What I mean by that is they need to slow down, we all do, and say, what do I really know about this? And how is it that I know it? We need to identify any assumptions that we're making. Assumptions aren't knowledge, they masquerade as knowledge. So we got to surface our assumptions, figure out what they are, then we got to test them out. So on any subject, the law of consecration, the first vision, the restoration of priesthood, translation of the Book of Mormon, the Book of Abraham, anything else, this works. If you'll slow down your thinking, or everything else in the world we live conditions us to have fast thinking. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to ultimate questions, we need to slow down our thinking. Not get in a hurry, not just say, well, Google it, and whatever comes up at the top of the Google list, that's what I know, all right? That's a fast-thinking way to not know really anything. We need, in our slow thinking, we need to figure out what are the best sources of knowledge, right? Who can tell me what I want to know? Can an antagonistic person, is that the best source of knowledge here, right? If I want to know what happened in the sacred grove, who would I ask? How would I discover that knowledge? What sources of knowledge would I seek from? So these are just principles for thinking slow. Slow is another way of doing what Section 88 of the Doctrine and Covenants invites us to do when it says seek learning out of the best books diligently by study and by faith. You know all this stuff as well or better than I do. So what's your answer?
Well, it feels like you're hitting the nail on the head, because a common tactic used by people that question the church is to just pile on the questions really, really fast. And unless you have an eloquent response right off the bat, they're on to the next question, right? But in reality, almost all those questions have a good answer to them, but it sometimes takes time to explain context, to give the background.
To think slow,
Yeah, you have to think slow in order to answer some of these hard things, because a good example would be the law of consecration, you know, to basically say, well, because we're not doing what they did in 1831 when the law was received, we must not be living it today.
Yeah.
The principles are still in place, but obviously we don't do hardly anything in the 21st century the way we did it in the 19th century. So that's not to say we don't still live the law of consecration.
Right.
We just live it differently.
Yeah, that was a good example of thinking slowly.
Yeah. And slow thinking isn't a problem for me, is the good news. I'm a slow thinker. Any other things you would say about these questions that sometimes trouble people?
Well, I have found from my own experience and talking to, you know, I don't know how many people have you talked to, hundreds by now, right, or more of people who are questioning this or that or seeking desperately and diligently to know how to find answers. I've discovered that it's almost always not as simple as I or they might assume. Mm-hmm. Our whole reasons for our questions and stuff are complicated. We're complicated people. And so it's good, again, to slow down and try to figure out what's motivating us, what's driving us, where are my questions coming from? So, you know, you can ask questions on a cognitive level, and then you can be metacognitive about your questions. You can be thoughtful about your thoughts. Why am I asking these questions? What is it that's really going on inside of me? What am I worried about? What am I looking for? What would, you know, if I were to find an answer to this question, what would that look like? What would it mean to me? Would I just then have another question? Or is there some quest that I'm on? And so the more clearly we can think about what we're wanting and needing, the better. And then for those of us who want to love God and our neighbor by helping them with these things, we can do better at listening and hearing what it is that people are really wanting to know, really asking about. Sometimes we are quick to, I've got all these facts in my back pocket, and I'm really excited to make this about me by telling them, demonstrating how much I know. And really, most often what's needed is a listening ear and a real effort to hear, to love by hearing what folks are saying and letting them think through and feel through their own quest for truth, you know, to sort of be with them, a companion on the journey more than a lecturer at the front of the room. Now, I say that as if I did it well, and I don't do it well, but I know those are good, sound practices.
Thank you for listening to Why Religion. This podcast is a production of religious education at Brigham Young University in Provo, Utah. My name is Anthony Sweat, the host and producer. The Why Religion podcast team also includes, from BYU Religious Education, Jared Halverson, Ryan Sharp, Hank Smith, Beverly Yellowhorse, Elena Wainsgard, and Brad Wilcox. Recording, mixing, and original music was done by BYU student Mitchell Bashford. Say hi, Mitchell.
Hey, guys.
Original music and scoring for Why Religion podcast was also created by the fabulous BYU student musicians Grant Cagle,
Sam Clausen,
Colette Jones,
and Alistair Scheuermann.
If you enjoy what you've heard, please like and subscribe to Why Religion on wherever you get your podcasts and leave us a rating. It really helps. And join us next time as we continue to bring the Everyday Latter-day Saint fascinating gospel studies done by Brigham Young University religion professors to enlighten your mind and strengthen your faith.